a little slow.
Especially in these times of stay at home.
Oh yeah, I forgot about that part. Normally Thursday would be the one where you go, let's start the weekend early, guys. Let's go out at 4 o'clock. It's summer, you know. How's the weather over there, by the way?
It's quite beautiful. We've got a blue sky today. No rain. I think it's going to be close to 80 here today.
Wow, that is insanity.
It's a little cold in Birmingham this morning.
Is it?
Started in the 50s this morning.
Oh boy, that's not good.
But it's beautiful.
Yeah, we had the kids running around in the garden with water hoses yesterday. That's how hot it was here. They were laying on towels in the sun, which was insane. That's Seattle I'm talking about, by the way, the Pacific Northwest. My friends in San Diego were complaining that it was freezing and raining. And I'm like, well, this time we got you. Uh-huh.
We have tornadoes coming this weekend, though.
The what?
We have some tornadoes coming this weekend, though.
Oh, boy, that's not good.
They've already predicted nasty weather for Easter Sunday.
Oh, boy. And then you sit inside, too, so... Anyway, let's kick it off. I wanted to share with you all today a bit of my flow of concepts. Good morning, all. And if others join, then we can just loop them in. Good morning. And so I think, please, if you have questions, just let me know or interrupt me. If you have, or throw them in the chat or whatever. I'm just doing kind of a free form kind of talk about concepts and my love for this app. And we can discuss some other apps as well. I'm a big freak of tools and pushing the use of tools in product design and beyond. So I love doing that. I kind of hooked up with these guys fairly early. As soon as I saw the app, I don't know, it was like 5-6 years ago, I was immediately smitten. Because, of course, of the Copic wheel. So as soon as you open the app, you see the markers. And, you know, we grew up with markers, you know, back in the day. And I saw those colors and I'm like, that's interesting. Somebody understands designers here. So, yeah, give it a try. But what I wanted to do today is just show you a little bit the flow of why I think concepts is so powerful for a workflow as a creative.
Hey, Bart.
Yeah.
Can you do a little intro of yourself? Tell us about your education and a little bit about your career so people who come on and watch this after you're not here have an idea of that.
I should probably switch on the video. I forgot to do that. Okay, good morning. I didn't do my hair yet, but Bart Massee, I am originally from the Netherlands, went to the Design Academy in the Netherlands in 91. Design Academy is quite a well-known European institution that's based on the Bauhaus principles and became later very well-known for its kind of provocative conceptual design thinking. I think it still is. I don't know if you guys ever heard of Lidewij Edelkort, but she's the head of the school for the last decade, and she's a leading trend speaker and a trendsetter. And the school is kind of based on counter thinking, right? To turn everything upside down and to think, go against the grain. So you see some of those Dutch designers coming out with some pretty strong pieces of conceptual art. There's these guys that do these bridges of metal 3D printing, robots printing across themselves across a canal. There's these guys that do some insane furniture, and there's guys and girls, obviously. So yeah, I don't know. I don't know the full history, you know, of all the names right now. But it's a school that's kind of, you get trained into provoking the industry. Basically, that's actually the bottom line, right? So my background is industrial design. Did man and transportation there as a master's, or not a master's, sorry, as a choice field. It was a bachelor's. Moved on to become a freelance designer for a few years, working for a variety of companies in the Netherlands. There weren't a lot of jobs when I graduated, so I just decided to start my own design company. Was relatively successful with that. Then back in 95, so this is dating me a little bit, but I was actually one of the first to code an HTML website. So in 95, we talked about it a little bit in the intro the other day. having a coded, you know, HTML website was kind of unique. So these days everybody has a website portfolio, but that, I was one of the early waves of that. And through that, I got in touch with design agencies in the US. That was one of my goals. I thought, hey, goals was, if you want to talk to these guys in the US, these owners of design agencies, you need to have a way to present your work. So through that, I got a job in Chicago, went to Chicago in 97 for 3 years. Worked for Thermos, Baxter, Coleman, a whole slew of products. The cool thing about working in a consultancy, obviously, being that you have the pace, you know, you have the pace of projects that are like fast paced. You go through a lot of really cool projects and research projects. The downside of a consultancy is obviously that you don't get to finish your designs all the way to perfection. You're just going to throw them over the fence and you pray and hope that it becomes something acceptable, and often it's not, because you're not involved in the long train of execution. But yeah, that's my background. And I went back to Philips in the Netherlands in 2000 and have been with Philips Design for 15 years. Philips Design is a pretty powerful design organization with a very high standard of processes and cultural expression. So really focusing on high design in that sense. So I learned a lot there for 15 years and came to the States again with Philips to Seattle to work on the health and wellness, and then switched to HP. And ever since I'm working at HP as the head of the advanced design for print for Ken Musgrave, who graduated from the University of Auburn, I believe, as an alumni. So Ken hired me there and I've been very fortunate to work with him. And my passion has always been product design visualizations, which is something that's traditionally not valued very high in the Netherlands. I think you guys are way ahead of the game in that sense in the States with your, you know, your car design schools and your focus on craft, the art of visualization. And that's I have a passion for that. So I've always been pushing myself into that direction. And currently very busy with VR, XR and those types of technologies as well. So My goal is to always push the boundaries of where design is heading. And I've got invited to a podcast next week to talk about where design tools are heading in the sense of game design tools, Blender, Unity, you know, all those types of tools where you see more and more designers heading a little bit in that direction because of 3D printing in color. You need to do UV mapping for that. So I'm very busy with VR and kind of the blending of the design tools more in the direction of game design tools. So I guess it's one of my passions that I do. So that's it in a nutshell, maybe a little bit too long, but that's the background in a nutshell. I can jump into concepts.
That's great. Thanks, Bart. Yeah, thank you.
If there are any particular angles of what you want to hear from concepts, I already heard there's some, you know, some of you that may have downloaded it, others may, you know, I think there's a free version, but I'm not sure if it has everything in it. So I cannot, know exactly where the boundaries of what's in the free version, what's not. But anyway, maybe you've dabbled with it. I'll share a couple of articles that are, can you see the screen, by the way? Am I not sharing a screen?
Yes.
The Design Astrea bottle is one of them. That's an article that they published in 2018. I designed this bottle, which is actually, that was kind of like outside my job. I do design work and I've designed this water bottle. You can see it on the video. It's a pretty cool surfaced thing here, which has this straw and then it has this fill lid, which we came up with. You can see them still in the stores. It has this really cool logo here on the front. So this is the black and digital red version, as they called it. But this whole thing was basically designed with on an iPad with concepts and then in CAD. So I mean, that whole process is described in this document, where you see some of the process sketches of how I explained. The way I wanted to do this was super lean because I didn't have a lot of time. I'm doing this in my evenings, right, next to my day job. This is America. You have to have a second job and a third job, right, to make ends meet. So working in, somebody asked me, can you design this bottle for me? And I'm like, well, I have three kids. I only have so many hours in the day. So my process has to be extremely efficient. So what you see in this picture is what I agreed with them is here's a normal design process. And those orange things are the focused pieces of contribution that I can deliver to you because I only have limited time, but because I have the experience, I can do it in a very focused way. So only a few, it still became hundreds of hours, but I wanted to do it fairly compact. But as you can see, this shows you that a quick flow diagram, screenshot, snap, boom, and went straight to the client to explain my proposal of how to work. These are some storyboards. So I think Concepts is extremely good for a quick storyboarding of this is my entire design process proposal to them in the beginning. There's a debriefing. There's going to be a brand exercise. Then there's a technology breakdown. I'm not sure if you can see my mouse moving around, but I'm kind of going through the boards here real quick. Then there's kind of this mood board phase. There's this values, principles of what the brand, how the brand translates into the design. Then there's kind of this experience flow of what's happening and what's not working in the normal bottle flow. What are the detractors? And then you get to your A, B, C, D concept. So I kind of compressed this whole design process into a nugget, into a really fast, high-speed process. You see some early sketches. Already here, you can see the cool blend between vector-based and pixel-based stuff, which I think is really powerful in Concepts. The other thing that you can see here in this sketch is sketching with what I call sketching with light. So it's super important if you do your art to realize, you see these designers sometimes that they're like, oh, I need to visualize an LED, and they just grab an orange Photoshop airbrush and just brush some orange on whatever the drawing is. Now the secret, obviously, with light is there cannot be light if there is no darkness. So when you want to draw something with light, you have to always go a few steps down in darkness, turn down the lights in the room or on the paper. And then with sketching with light, you can start bringing that to life. So it's a really cool exercise to try. As you can see, I bring the gray. I always have this kind of gray type of background. Then if you start making things pop, you can go both ways. You can go darker and lighter. So that's kind of a trick that, so just to, for instance, to visualize glass, you know, one of the books I studied seriously is Scott Roberts, How to Render. I have it over here. You know that guy? It's this guy that does these amazing concept art, concept cars. Scott Robertson. I don't see faces of recognition right now, so I'll pull it up real quick. Skoro, concept art. Okay, you guys hear me okay?
We can.
I just want to make sure I make sense when I talk through this stuff. So is this Scott Robertson? That's not it. Go back. I meant this guy. So he makes these books. I think he's from CCS or something like that, but he has these books. Oh, here it is. I'm sure you recognize this guy. He makes these books that are, you know, this stuff. The cool thing about this is his How to Render books are absolutely insane. I'm sure you guys have amazing books at school as well, at the uni. How to Render. Nope. Anyway, I'll look it up later. I'll send you the link. He does an extremely thorough analysis of working with light and that kind of stuff. And you can really learn a lot from it. I always love it. Anyway, I might go. So mood boarding concepts is really good for mood boarding, to just drop some stuff in quickly and then either draw on top of it or mood board on top of it. Little doodles, little sketches, and then little design exploration, detailed engineering type sketches. You pull in some photos and you just draw on that, make some notes, snap screenshots, send it back. It's a really quick way to work with the engineering team. Here again, just exploring some ideas with the engineering team in 2017. A bunch of filters that go inside this thing. So there's a super cool, I don't know if I can pull it out right now. There's this super cool filter inside that we developed. Can you see this? That is actually, it has a spring. I came up with this idea of a spring on the bottom. And this is, everything is designed on this thing. And you see here the series of quick, kind of, it's almost a bit of a styling exercise. I'm embarrassed to say. That's normally a word I normally would avoid it. But I'm just trying to get all the functional traits into a form that fits the bill. And then here you see the surfacing work, which I did with a guy in Spain. So I have a geometry developer that I work with. I can do the CAD, but it takes me 3 weeks. my friend, the specialist in Spain who does all the surfaces for Philips, does it on his balcony overnight. So you know what I mean? He's a guru of this stuff. He designs Porsches. He does Porsche surfaces for production. So you can trust him to, for instance, do something like this, which is an amazing surface exercise. We spent quite a lot of time of combining all these features. But here you see how I use concepts to drop in some screenshots, draw over some details, send it back to him. And then there's the end result. And that's us with the bottle. And it's a pretty cool success. The other stuff I do is kind of more this stuff. This is another thing they published. Oh, you see, 2016. So yeah, we've been working together for a while now with concepts. This is just my game design, crazy game design stuff. And they just wanted to publish a whole bunch of this things. The cool thing about these is that this is all fills, like this robot that you see here, it's just fills. So we started exploring this really weird way of drawing that had nothing to do with pencil. We just start drawing straight with fills. So I can show you later how you can do that. 2016. And at this time, the cool thing, so one of the things I think we talked about the other day is the opportunity to work with the industry, the software industry, to develop software that you like. And you can do it. So I latched on to these guys from the beginning, and David and Ben Merrill are the owners of this company. And I was just every Saturday when I was drawing, I was emailing with them. It's like, oh, I need this feature. I need that feature. Here's a bug. So I started developing this relationship with them because they value super users that really dive in, you know, and all these software companies are open to this collaboration. So being a beta tester is fantastic because you can actually shape the industry. So it's one of my favorite things to do. So we became kind of friends and I met these guys. So I'm almost a constant beta tester for them. Here's some game design sketches of my crazy games that I make. Oh, there's my daughter testing one of the games. I forgot she's in there. But it's just an example of the variety of stuff you can get out of concepts. Here it is, for instance, here this pencil quality is just insane, right? It's almost, I would almost say it's a scanned pencil drawing, but it's not, it's actually concepts. Anyway, so that's an overview. Oh yeah, then I did this bug. This is actually one of those Scott Robinson type exercises where you go very slowly, you take a picture as a practice, you take a photo. So I threw in this bug as a photo, started just with fills, drawing it in a little bit, dropping in a few more fills here, just in gray tones. It's like a 15 minute exercise, dropping in some greens. This was even before I knew how the color sucker works. So I just picked some greens, I think. Then just grab a pencil. Here you see the Copic marker wheel, right? You grab a pencil and just put some tones in it. Those are the types of exercises that that Scott Robertson would advise you to do. Oh, and then in the end, I actually launched a couple of games on the App Store. That's my...
Was the little green bug your keyshot rendering of the beetle?
It was actually, yes. Okay. I actually have this out in the App Store if you're interested. It's one of my games. I'll send the link. I have a gaming company that I run, and this was my first launch I did. But the cool thing is, all you need is this thing, and you have your entire workshop with you. You know, there's an insane amount of tools in here. Now, the other guy, and I showed it a little bit earlier when we were test running this morning, is Osama. So there's a few guys that were there from the beginning, and this guy, I don't even know where he lives, Egypt or something like that. He's an architect, and he just publishes on the concepts Facebook all the time, and I'll show you. The one thing I wanted to show you here is the fill tool. So what we both started doing in the beginning, and the developers were really surprised. They're like, what the hell are you guys doing with the fill tool? I'm like, we like the fill tool. Why? Because you can draw with the fill tool. Normally the fill tool is like click, click, you know, Photoshop is like click, 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 or in Illustrator, the fill tool is horrible, right? But suddenly you had a fill tool with a pencil, and that created, as you can see later, how this guy uses it. Let me switch forward a little bit to when he starts filling. By the way, you also notice he uses a actual plastic guide. So he literally just drops a guide on his, I haven't done it yet, but he uses like the old way when we all used to use templates all the time. There are some pretty cool templates in here, but he's the first one that just grabbed a plastic ruler and just start drawing on your iPad screen, which is insane. Now here, watch this. It might be choppy, the video, but what he's doing here is just using the fill tool. And then later he'll start doing shadows with the fill tool. And that's an exceptionally powerful thing. I use it all the time in product design visuals. And I'll show you the best, quickest way to set that up. So I'll send a link to the video, but here, this is not even shadows yet. This is just fills, but in a minute you'll see him drop some shadows down. Do you get the gist of it, or is it really choppy? I heard it was choppy earlier.
I think it shows pretty well.
Yeah.
It's pretty amazing how rapidly the color drops in there.
I think he sped it up a bit, but this guy is fast anyway. And the cool thing about it, it's grit. You know what I mean? It's just plowing through it. And this, here you go. You see that shadow of that lighthouse or tower there? You just drop this in and it multiply, because you have multiply on, it goes over everything and you get this, you can make these insane layers of, so an architectural drawing with shadows is probably one of the most efficient, fastest way of doing it. I've done a couple of those too in the past with the combination of Shaper 3D. So if you get Shaper 3D and this, you can do concept work in extremely fast fashion. So any questions so far or thoughts? Otherwise, we'll go to a live demo.
Sounds good. I'm interested in knowing kind of the settings behind a lot of that, but
yeah. Okay, yeah, I'll try to get to that. That's actually what I wanted to show you guys. So if I go to the chat, oh, there you go, how to render. Somebody did that, thank you.
It's really interesting how you, just using the fills can actually really quickly drop the color in without having to have brushed it all with your pen or.
Yeah. And then little people, it's architecture, but I think for design, you'll notice that I'll start doing the same for industrial design as well. Okay, let me get my thing cooking here.
So I've been doing Google searches on things while you've been talking and dropping them into the chat.
Oh, awesome. Thank you. Yeah, it's hard to stop share. It's hard to, okay, let me just 1 minute as I try to set this. Why is this thing still recording? Little break here. I'm not in there yet with my iPad, am I? Oh, I am in there. I am in there. Okay. Start broadcast. 3, 2, 1. Boom.
There you go.
Okay. Resolution looks a little choppy. It is a little choppy, isn't it?
I think it depends on everybody's speed that they're watching from, honestly.
Yep. Okay. Where to start? The fill tool. So let me just make, so you're in concept, you can hold and press. So first of all, you have libraries, right? So you have, if you click here on the left top, you'll see all your project libraries. So basically you can go and that Australia library, for instance, there are not that many drawings in it. You click on the drawings. I won't go through the full flow of the actual, you know, all the little details of project management, you know, pinch, zoom in and out. This actually looks like it's a thrown in drawing afterwards. But this is, for instance, one of those example of, so you hit the cross in the corner. Oops. You hit the project list and you can go to all your different libraries. For instance, here, you basically have all your drawings nicely laid out. One of the things I just wanted to quickly show you is to the use of photography, for instance, or mood boarding. What I do quite a lot is I drop a photo in somewhere. And to do that, you have here on the right, you see let me grab a pencil so I can show you where I am. Pink with a very thick layer. So over here, there you go. is the, you see in that corner, you have the grid, snap, measure, and guide. And above that, there's a little arrow. Tap that twice and you get to your import settings. And then basically you can drop a picture in there like that and delete it again. So in that way, I've dropped in this picture as an example, just as a first example to show you how I would work on top of that. So you have your layers. So if I go here, I noticed when I did demos, it's hard to see for people where I am. If you go here and tap on this thing, you see your layers popping up. Now, the best thing you need to know about this is this little switch here, which is the manual switch. If you switch it to automatic, whatever tool you pick becomes drops on the right layer. And you have, this is kind of a trick that took me a long time to figure out. But as soon as you put it on automatic, doesn't matter what tool you pick here on the left, you see on the wheel there. Oops. If I hit this one, you see the layer changes. If I hit fill, the layer changes. If I hit that one, it goes to pen. If I hit airbrush, which I never use, it creates a layer of airbrush. So that's the cool thing. One of the most powerful tricks to learn is that. Then let's say I got my, what I do is actually I draw sometimes, just to show you a quick trick, directly onto a photo with some concept. So for instance, here we're doing an integrated printer that fits a gorgeous office. What better way to do it than to just quickly sketch on, well, that's annoying, my undo setting has changed, item picker. Let me talk over the basics a little bit in a second, but this is a really quick way to let me just grab a little bit of a thinner line to just go directly in a scene and say, oh, okay, I want to think about a little concept, blah, 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 that fits this. And then just with the layers, you start adding in some fills and stuff like that. So this is just a quick trick to get into a scene of understanding, for instance, an environment or a space and wanting to get inspired. It's a really good way to do that. For instance, here, imagine you're an artist and you want a big A3 plotter or an A3 printer that fits that space. You can draw directly in that space. This one, for instance, is completely done with fills. So the way to do that would just be to literally just draw. There's one setting that annoys me, that's the double. So if you go to, just real quick, intermezzo here. If you go to the star wheel up on the right corner, you have these options. And one of them is gestures. And then you can do your two finger tap, your three finger tap, and your four finger tap. And I always have the two finger tap on undo, so that when I do something, I screw it up, I can instantly hit two finger tap, and I'm back on undoing. You cannot see what I'm doing here, but that's okay. So, for instance, I have a relatively okay opacity and I can literally just start drawing with fills right on top of here and say, okay, I want a bit something like this, blah, blah, blah. And then if you sit down and do it carefully, you can obviously make something really nice. This is just an example of how I did that one, right? So, and then you can go in and clean it up. But as you can see, if I have it on automatic, you'll see the layer coming in on the, I'm just highlighting the fill layer there. Because I selected the fill tool, it'll enter directly the fill layer. Now I want to just delete whatever I did, double finger tap as many times as you want to go back. This is a very neat example, in my view, of being inspired, you know, getting art, some mood board stuff on there. You have your mood board stuff. What do you do now? Oh, I want to draw directly on top of it. That's kind of a rare thing to do. You normally don't do that. Let me just go over the basics real quick for everybody. So on the top left corner, you have this wheel. If you hold it, you can actually draw it around wherever you would like to have it. You see in the middle, you see these squares that indicates you could place it in any of those corners, you see? So I always have it in the top left. You can also have it floating top left. And if you do that, you can also tap hold and scale it, I believe. Some of the things that change in recent updates, I thought you could scale it in and out, but it doesn't. You can also hide it and lock it into the corner like that, and then it's just hanging there, which I think is a really nice way to do it. Now, obviously, in the middle is your Copic markers. I mean, this is what blows everybody away the first time they see it, the Copic markers. And there's a very good palette system in here as well. So, for instance, if you want to start using colors, let's switch it to 100% real. No, just the basic real quick of the color wheel. Obviously, you have the opacity, which is set your opacity. What you see there, those four numbers give you four different standard settings. So if you always set this to 50, you set this one to 25, you set this one to 10, you can shortcut to those. You see? So you got your 100, your 27, your 13. So let's go to 100% right now. Draw that curve. As you can see, it's on automatic. So I immediately am drawing on the fill curve. The cool thing about the color palettes, which is extremely important for the rendering with light, you know, you need to understand your color palettes, is the button here, which brings up your palette thing. And it's quite powerful, actually. And I actually never use the RGB sliders that much because I always start with the Copic wheels. But you can obviously just go in here and slide and optimize your colors. I find it a little bit tricky the way they did it, but okay, it works. You can also type in your hex numbers, and then you can create your own palettes as well. The cool palettes there are the ones down here, down below. For instance, monochromatic. Everything that's circled with a black, black band around it is active in your pop-up bar. So analogous, monochromatic, complementary, I don't need that, triads, bit crazy, and shades. Shades is really important. And then later you can also create your own palettes up here. But as you can see, the ones I selected up here on the top left corner, you see this little menu going on right here. That's where those reside. So as you can see here, this is shades. This is that middle one, and that's that one. Can you see as I slide between the three? So now I can easily go, and I have selected my little base color here. I can now go and work in shades and say, okay, that has changed. That's no longer the same value, sorry. And now I can say, okay, I got a strange lighted cube with three different sides going on. And then if I have also let's say I have a black tool set up as well with a little bit of a medium thingy, you could quickly make your cube with your light. And as you can see, these are just fills. So that's just talking about the color palettes, right? And then if you want to go back to that same, so that same tool will remain in the same vein. And then obviously you can go back and also do the color picker and pick a color. As you can see, this color picker, pick a color from the screen, and you're back in that exact same vein. So that's something about the color palettes. Then the cool thing about these slots is you can create your tool set such that each slot has your favorite one. So I usually have a black one, a black fill, a white fill, and I don't do a lot with pencils, but obviously you can do a lot with pencils, and then a line. So set this up to your own needs, and then every new drawing that you start will have the exact same setup for you. About the tools, you click on one and you can test up here. So there's a little bit of a test thingy. Then you can say, hey, I'm just going to explore the standard pencils. And then here you got all your brushes. There's quite a few decent standard brushes. The marker is actually quite interesting. But I actually usually do a lot just with the basic pen. I don't go too crazy with all the line thicknesses things and the pressure even. I just use a fairly simple setup for clean, crisp product design work. Now, a caution, a warning on the erasers. We've always complained about the erasers because it doesn't really delete stuff. It actually, they never really created the software for really deleting pixels. So what the eraser does is, why is it not erasing? Interesting. It's actually only erasing on the layer that it's at. Okay, so that's a different story. So even though it looks like it's erasing here, by the way, it's on straight. Now, the reason that it's a straight line is super important is you see this square, a little squiggly thing here. This is your smoothing, right? smoothing to 100% is straight lines. It's one of the most powerful things in the history of art. Nobody ever had this. You know, Van Gogh, those guys, they all had to do it freehand. But now, and I'm on the stupid eraser, let me just go quickly to the pencil. I never use the eraser. It's not a real eraser. It drops masks on top of your art and becomes a complete mess. So don't, my advice is just don't use erasers. If you need clean Photoshop work, bring it in from Photoshop or whatever, but the eraser is no. And I told those guys, they know, and they'd have to rewrite their code. Because now if I select, you see what happens? You see the strokes are actually strokes that are living there, and that's kind of stupid. It's not just, hasn't removed pixels. It's actually masks. It's like an illustrator having a clipping mask, and it's a disaster. Because if you start scaling, it becomes bad. What I wanted to show you though, which is super powerful, is, oh, please go away. Okay, so to delete these, you simply click delete. Oh, they're not both deleted. There's another trick I'll tell you in a minute that has to do with the menu down south, down here, down at the bottom, the item picker. I'll tell you that in a minute. Let's go talk quickly about the smoothing there, right? So everybody understands, you know, you can do, let me make the line a little thicker. Let's go to a bit thicker, like 11 points. So take note of your zoom. So in the top right corner, you see zoom. Make sure that if you start drawing, you're actually close to 100%, because otherwise you can get screwed up pretty quickly too. Let's say you're at 100% zoom, you see there in the top right corner. Then you select your line thickness. And then you're at 100%. So then you immediately see that you have a broader range of selecting a pencil. Now let's say I got the smoothing on 25. So if I draw something now, I got a decent smooth lines. If I go up a bit to 50%, you see that it's actively smoothing. If I go to 70%, it's actually becomes almost such that you can draw if you're really, and let's say if you want to draw a really clean cube, let's say you go to 50% and you say you can almost make really smooth radii, you see? So for product design, this is actually quite handy if you do have to draw a lot of cubes like we did the other day. We had a project that was a cube, so all we did was cubes the whole day. So you can actually fairly rapidly draw a cube, put some shades on it or whatever, and you have a little cube. If I press and hold, the lasso tool pops up. You can just drag around everything and delete. But the cool thing shows up when you do shading to 100%. Oops, I was not in the drawing tool. Then you have straight lines. And this is literally since the 15th century masters, nobody has seen this yet. it's the coolest thing in the world. I mean, like you saw with Osama earlier sketching, he's not related, by the way, he's a very friendly chap. Politically incorrect comment there. No, he's an amazing artist. We have to edit that out. Sorry, that's the Dutch person in me talking. You can really quickly with a straight line tool, this is the straightest line you'll ever get, right? So whatever you want to draw, whether it's a printer or a building, this tool is phenomenal because it's just super quick and super easy. I don't think I'm really warmed up yet this morning. You make sure again, you see the sorting is not on automatic, it's on manual. Make sure you click it on automatic, otherwise it doesn't go. And now you see, because I screwed up, my line work is actually on the wrong layer. So how do you fix that? I don't know if there's a quick fix, but what I do is I copy, delete, go to the pen layer, hold, and paste. Be rigorous about your layers because it's going to screw you up later. So now, if I go back to automatic, I can do a quick, what's going on?
Because your iPad screen, Bart, how big are you sketching on?
Pro, it's like one of the first pros. Why is it not working? Hello? Is it bad resolution?
No, oh, I was curious as to how you were working.
I know why it's not working, because funnily enough, I have the I've never seen this before. I have the smoothing at 100%. That's therefore my thingy wasn't working. So now I don't need smoothing for this tool. That's ridiculous. So I go to like 60%, and then you can say, you can do whatever. And it's because it's layered, you can do more. And then you go with a little white. So you pick a, this is not going to be my best sketching ever, guys, because I'm in like talking mode. But the cool thing now, again, sketching with light would be to say, okay, yeah, there's a piece of paper, this, and maybe there's some more light here. There might be a reflection there.
What are you doing to change your color that quick?
What's that?
What are you doing to change your color that quick? Is that the color up at the top?
What color? I have a tool here that's white and I have one that's black.
Okay, because you were going from like a 80% gray to like a 70% gray real quick, and I didn't know what you were doing to do that.
Yeah, I think I just hit this and just went between these settings. Okay. You can have your presets. I believe that's what I did. I guess it was an auto mode. I don't know. So this is a little bit just in a nutshell. So working with layers, super important. Tools, and then in the tools, the important things are, I think, the smoothing. Ensure you're on the right layer. Never use erase. I would literally just even get rid of erase from your toolbar and just put something else there, like a soft pencil or something. And obviously, you can start with pencil, right? I mean, the normal way of doing things. Again, if you have it on automatic, it goes on a pencil layer. So then you can literally go nuts with it and sketch whatever you want in pencil, and then go over it with something else, maybe like a straight to some light, maybe again, and sketch with light and then some black.
What do you do to erase?
That's a good segue to the next topic. So I think we discussed everything about the wheel here. Now my wheel disappeared. Here it is again. It became a bar, so you can see that this thing can also become a bar. Drop it back in the corner, and now there is a way to scale it. Oh, there we go. I just did it. So you see, you can pinch it and scale it smaller, bigger if you wanted to. And then you press hold to drop it in the corner. Press hold, drop it in the corner. And then the little 3-4 bars is your layer thing. You can hide it. Let's, to your question, was it Steven or whoever asked the question?
Yes.
Down here, let's go to this menu now. Big arrow, because it's hard to see for you guys. This menu down there is basically very interesting. You really have to understand it to be able to work with it. It houses the important tools of selection, of color picking, of layer selection, and locking, and stuff like that. So for instance, let's say out of this mess, let's go to another drawing that's maybe a little more fun. It doesn't matter. Let's say out of this, I still want to edit. Let's say I drop below this layer. So now I override automatic. I go to manual and I drop a car color in here with fill, like that. Now that's on a different layer. I switch back to automatic. And now I want to start messing with that drawing and tweak and optimize it a little bit. So you press and hold the screen to bring up that menu. And if you go down to the left, you see item picker. You know where I'm at, it's the blue arrow. The blue arrow is pointing at where I'm at. Item picker, color picker, lasso. So lasso is obvious, right? That's your lasso. Then you can delete, you can duplicate. I said double tap, double finger tap to undo. Duplicate. Then I'll tell you later what you can do with it, because there's a lot of stuff you can do with with the object after you duplicated it, even taking it outside of iPad Pro straight into other software. I'm not a pro at that yet. Again, hold, finger down, hold. And I can also do, that was a lasso. I can also do item picker. So now I go in and pick, select that color, for instance, of that car. See how I highlighted it. Again, lock it, duplicate it, copy it, scale it, or deform it. So let's say I go and duplicate it. I'll show you some deformation possibilities. You see the four dots? If you select one of those dots, you can actually completely tweak the form with one of those dots. Double tap to undo. If I select two of those dots, I can completely deform it in a kind of one-sided uniform scale. If I select the whole thing, I can two fingers down on the board, scale, pinch, and rotate, which is pretty powerful. Or I can also, down in the menu, look at the arrow again, lock rotate, lock scale, and just have nothing, just move. That's really important if you want to line stuff up. You bring in a picture, lock your rotate, lock your scale, because otherwise they, if you move them, they, it's very easy to rotate them. So that's important to know about those two. When something's selected and you just want to make a very clean copy that is just a copy, now I hit copy and it's not rotating. If I have those off, I make a copy and oops, sorry, you know, it's off. So it's us designers, that's like walking in your parents' house putting a painting straight, right? It's that frustrating thing. Okay, so showing that, going back in time, back, just tap, double tap. It's back on. Now let's say I go item picker color change, so I can pick different. So a cool thing, a cool functionality of this would be, I'm just gonna remove the arrow. So I got one finger on the pressing, I got my thumb on the little thing. So whilst holding down your finger, you select color picker, lasso, or item picker. I wanna do lasso now. So you have two fingers on there. Delete these two and gone. And what I will do now is, again, lasso this, delete. Then I will lasso this guy. I will hit copy. Then I zoom out on these. And then I say, now I hold my finger down and I go in item picker. And I pick out of my palette, for instance, the green one. So I created my palette already. What's going on? Something's not working. Sorry, let me select it again. Pick the green. And I go again, hold item picker. I don't have a lot of palettes open at the moment. So let me just go back to the palettes. Say I got a beautiful palette that I created, the calm pastel. And now in here should be the calm pastel. There it is. Super handy. And that's really quick for range, creating ranges of products, solutions. Boom, you copy. I'm unable to scale because scale is off. Okay, I scale. I just leave them there. And then I go in and maybe select another palette. So let's go Vibrant watercolor. If I now go to the right, you see there's that palette. I click hold. Item picker, and in this sense, you can really set up your palettes and work with your ranges of your design. I mean, if you do need to do some production work or whatever, and then if you wanted to, you could click hold, go to back to the lasso, and maybe group the whole thing, and now it's grouped. Now I'll show you another cool trick as we go. Oh, wait, hang on. There's a couple more things on the bottom here. So again, arrow is where I'm looking at. The other cool things down there are the all or active. So if you only want to select on active layer, it only selects the fill items. So now I think I probably locked this, so I don't know if that's going to work because I locked that group. But now if I just do a lasso and it's on active, as you can see down there, I think it's only going to select the fill stuff. Yeah, and it doesn't work because I just grouped those cars. So let's go back and ungroup those cars. Now they should not be grouped. They still are. So I ungrouped them with the locking icon there. Now if I go and only active, so arrow is there. Is that an error? That's a bad arrow. You see the where it says active, toggle on all or only active. Now it's supposedly going to select only the fills. If I make a copy, you'll see that it's only the fills. Why didn't it do the color? Because the color is on a different layer for some reason. So as you can see in the layer tab, lasso, let's get rid of these arrows. I can't select them because they're not on the, so I need to switch back to all layers, select. If you go to a layer, just putting an arrow here of where I'm going to be talking about, any layer tab, you can select. And as you can see, you can either merge it down, just this one. You can duplicate. You can lock the layer, unlock the layer. And you can do the opacity as well for per layer. And obviously you can delete the layer. You can select everything on the layer. So it's super handy as well. It's kind of like Photoshop, the merge down. And what's this actually? And you can name the layer. Of course you can. Very important to set up all that stuff when you do a really complicated piece of art. You know, the more logic from the beginning they have, the less mess you have later, right? So unless you just do quick scribbles, then you don't have to worry about it. Okay, I think that's everything I know. I can tell you all from the bottom menu there. Go back to switching to automatic, and I'll talk a little bit about menu on the right. We're almost around. Big arrow to that one, and then I'll show you a few drawings of how I built stuff up. There's some extremely powerful functionality on this menu on the right. Do you have any questions on the left and the bottom side of the screen? I know it's kind of deep technical stuff, but I'll get to the showing some drawings later. But this, to me, these are like lifesavers. If you understand this stuff, you're flying like way faster. Okay, so I'll move on to the right here to the section that has the these powerful tools in it.
Are most of your designers working on tablets this way, as opposed to paper drawing?
I'm surprised. I mean, I'm an advocate, but I still do demos inside of our HP for designers, and I still see people doing all kinds of tools. There are people that are fanatic about it and have like HPZ books with concepts on it. There's a lot of Procreate fans. We have one amazing artist who is like an Instagram artist who does Fresco, Procreate. I have to send you a link of Jay Myers's work. It's amazing. I don't know. I'm one of the few that is fanatic about working digital like this, because it's just, for me, it's the best flow. You walk around in the office just with just your iPad, that you got everything in there. And I see a lot of people still in kind of sketch paper land, which blows my mind, but I still do it. I mean, I doodle, right? I doodle during the day on paper with a pen. So, okay, so shall we move into the area on the right? It's some of the most powerful functionality that we have. Let's say I take this little printer here, I duplicate it, I group it, and I put it here. And let's say if there's a cooler one, maybe. Oh, here you go. This is a little cooler. This has a little airbrush in it too. I duplicate it. I grab it again. It's tiny. Doesn't matter. Infinite scalability possibilities. I scale it up. As you can see, I rotate and scale active. Throw it over here, and let's take one of these cars. This is really cool. This is where the power of concepts really comes alive. One of the many ways. I lost some cool factor of this thing. What happened in the scaling, you see? So as you noticed, I scaled it, and a lot of the detail of that light sketch that's going on didn't scale properly, it actually disappears. So something funky is going on there with scaling, which I have to check into. I think the line thickness probably didn't scale up. So let me do a copy of it. And then I'll see what happens as I scale. That's the kind of tricky stuff you need to. Here again, you know, Pinterest board, drop it on there, and you got your inspiration going. I do not know why. Here, let me show you the difference. I hold. Oopsie daisy. So drop it on here. And as you can see, there it has a wonderful kind of quality of a bit of airbrush pencil on it, a little touch of light. And here they became really shitty scratches. So what happened as I scaled it up, it lost all of its, it lost the line thickness there. But okay, for now, let's delete the big one. What I wanted to show you here is the following tool. On the right here, you have your grid, which I don't have straight, which you can set in the settings as to dots, grids, and the grid size, units, millimeters, background. I always have a light gray background color, like that. That's the grid. Then the snapping, I don't think works super well. That's one of the things I don't really have down yet, the symmetry. And a lot of people go to Procreate for symmetry and snapping. I must say, I don't think Concepts is the best for it. I never really got to, if you want to make extremely detailed drawings, I'm not a huge fan of it. I hardly ever use it anyway. Measure, which I hardly ever use either. And then the most important one is the guides. So just to show you where I am. This actually is the only one that I use, is that is the guides. And there you have your circles. Double tap makes it round. So if you accidentally made, can you see the circle? It's hard to see.
You can see them.
You got the oval tool there. If you want to go back to round, you double tap in the middle. It's again one of those tricks that you have to know because it's really a pain in the neck. And yeah, basically you can either do a part of a circle. It gets a little bit of getting used to, I must say, because you draw outside of the circle. And sometimes if you touch it accidentally, you rescale the circle, which is kind of annoying. So you have to draw, let me switch it off real quick. I usually have it on three finger tap. So normally if you go to gestures, I have the three finger tap being the precision tools here, which is toggle shape guide. And then with three finger tap, I can bring it up or not. So now let's say I do that again, real quick on the guides, switch on guides. And let's say you wanna get a bit of a cylinder going here. Switch this to, am I still on automatic? Yep, switch that to, let's say a pencil drawing, whatever. So I lay down, that's too thin for you. You can't see that, sorry. Lay down a pencil drawing. Then I go back to my line tool for an elliptic type thing. And then I lay down an ellipse. It's a little thin. Two finger taps undo, hello. Two finger tap undo. Go to a bit thicker so that you can actually see what I'm doing. So there you go. Three finger tap is off. Tap hold to lasso select, duplicate, and then you could basically go and a lot of people just draw like this too. You just grab what you already have and then just go and duplicate a bunch of stuff. So that would be a way, hey, I don't see the middle anymore. That would be a quick way to build up some standard. Go to 100% again, and you can connect this if you wanted to. Draw some, whatever you wanted to draw, cylinder type thing. Give it a little bit of a fill, whatever, you know. This is just a quick demonstration of the guide tool. Again, double clicking on it would make it a full circle again. And this is where the limit of concepts becomes clear. For super precise work, the snapping, I find it that they haven't really cracked the nut on that one. So don't expect it to be like a cat-like 2D thing with snapping. I never got there, let's put it that way. So But what you do have is you have your line tool. Now this one is powerful, but to be completely honest with you, so the line tool works like this: two fingers, tap, hold, and also stretch. And then you could do and lay down some fairly precise. I got Snap-on, which is now annoying me. Then you can do some decent line work. Again, two finger move and rotate. So if you wanted to, you could do a really precise ruler thing. But as you saw, Osama does it with just he grabs just any old plastic ruler and uses it on the screen. The other option is, what I love is just go to 100% fill, and you basically have the same functionality, but quicker and more free hands. I'm not drawing anything at the moment, but you get the picture, right? So the line tool, you probably find you don't use that much. The ellipse tool you might find, and obviously the rectangle tool, double tap makes it square. Here I struggle a little bit with concepts to make it 100% aligned with the grid. I never really figured out how they want to do that. So I still have to talk to them and say, you guys, your grid work needs to be more sharp, but you can at least eyeball it and do your old class, 19, your old product design vignette, if we're still using them. If you wanted to do, you could go all the way and say, I'm on the pencil layer now. Let's do some crazy pencil work. Or marker, for instance, you grab your crazy marker, do a real old-fashioned background if you wanted to. Scale it up to the max. I usually don't do this stuff anymore, but you could if you wanted to do that and do your marker work. Anyway, I'm kind of focusing now on the tools that are basically rectangle and circle. But now the most exciting one in this corner, let me just delete this real quick, is the replication of objects. And this I believe is super powerful. So I'm now going to hit this, just an arrow with, you see the little downwards arrow, that's where I'm at. One of the things that you have here is the more, it says more. So what you can do here is go to market, which is you can download all kinds of asset packs. Sometimes could come in handy if you're doing app design, for instance. You can drop in some of these phone things and just have your phone. I'm sure they have more recent stuff too. Your Apple icon, obviously, you have Apple icons. You have Apple Watch. What other things do we have on there? So you can get libraries of all kinds of icons going. I don't use them a lot, but where it becomes really interesting is create your own libraries. And this is super powerful. As you can see, these are some of my libraries. For instance, here I have a little color palette that I made. And wherever I am, I'm just saying, okay, here's my little color palette. But the color palette is made just by those little shades of colors. As I explained earlier, you can mess with the palette and just grab those. And now if I want to go again, select item picker, all layers, I grab that one, I go to my color thing, and I can literally just pick out of this palette any color. Why does it do the whole thing now? Hello? Oh, it's grouped. Okay, so this thing is grouped, which means I need to ungroup it first, but you get the picture. So the cool thing about having your own palettes, your own standards, is that everything here you can create. These are some of the designs I did for another client. And you just kind of group them, you drop them in there. This is a water testing device that we were designing a while ago. Really, really rough little sketches. But now I can just pull them back up and drop them in because I made them in my library. And I'll show you how to do that. Delete, delete, undo, 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 undo. Don't need the Apple phone. So for instance, if you're doing your project and you need these screens for your phone, you just drop a phone in there, make a little template, duplicate, throw in your own objects, and then the next day you can make hundreds of them, hundreds of variations. So making a modular system of your stuff that you need is super powerful. It saves you tons of time. So the way to do it is I make a new library, plus. I thought I could name it. Can I name it? No, maybe not. Select an object. So click, drag, lasso. And you drag it over. Where is it? And grab this one. This is weird. Oh yeah, hit the plus symbol. Sorry. So you click drag around something, hit the plus symbol, and there you see on the right it has become one of your icons. This guy, for instance, maybe group it. What is important if you do this is to make sure that before you make it an icon, that you collapse it perhaps on one layer. Because one of the flaws is that if you have things that 10 layers, later on if you start dropping them back on, I don't know if they fixed it yet, each time you drop one on, it's an additional 10 layers. So you need to flatten it before you... I have to check with those guys if that's still the case, but otherwise your layer structure will become unmanageable. So now I have these three in a little library, and wherever I am, start a new drawing, maybe this little guy too. Plus. Now I can literally go to start a new drawing. Let's say I go back into project view. New drawing, just click new drawing. The cool thing about a new drawing is it'll be set up just like your old drawing. In this case, it has zero layers. So let's see what happens to the layer as I drop these guys in. Here's one. Yeah, as you can see, it turned to pencil. Interesting. Why is that? It was pencil, but it's 100% zoom. I go to 100% zoom. And I drop this guy in, and it's super big. Okay, interesting. And it's not scaling. I don't know what happened there. Did I draw it that big? I didn't think so. So those are the type of things you need to be aware of as far as scaling. And as you can see, it dropped in the three different layers. So if I drop in this little car here, as you can see, again, it added a few layers. If I scale it, the line drawing on the airbrush kind of... Some of the brushes... don't scale the line thickness. That's why it's so important that you are aware of your zoom in levels. If you're at 100%, stay at 100%. If you suddenly go out to helicopter view, it screws up your line thicknesses. So this is a super powerful way of building up all kinds of stuff with these boards. As you can see, I have little projects in here. For instance, these are little icons we made for some of the screen printing printers that we're doing, or a little robot printer that we're doing. And now if you start storyboarding, you create your object, you create some scenes, and boom, you can make a storyboard like there's no tomorrow, right? So this is one of the most powerful tricks in the book for us to use, I think, for us designers. For instance, here I have some printer stuff that I did, drop on a little 3D printer. Got another one going here, a kind of a vision of the future for a 3D printer. What's our language as we go forward, right? Is it like this? These are just some really quick doodles. And as you can see, it's kind of easy to make powerful artwork, or you see all these different concepts here. Robots. You can drop your logos in. This is a shitty execution, but if you wanted to, you can also do PNGs and then load them in there. So you can do a whole label, a brand identities thing. And then here's some other printer concepts that we did a while ago, where we made a mapping. So if you have to make, let's say you have all your concepts, you make a little doodle of each, and then you can do mapping with it and then move them around on a progressive, traditional. You can do your product design mappings with this. So for instance, here, a couple of printer concepts. These are kind of neat little icons because they're just really simple, very simple line drawings with a little bit of color to it. And as you can see, they tell the story of these little cute little concepts of printers, right? So we did a whole bunch of them. So we have, and then you can map these out. And here's a little kiosk. So for this kind of early concept work, this is super handy. There's another kiosk with a person next to it. So this is really, as you can see, the power of concepts comes alive in a few of these. If you manage your layers, you create clean basics, you create a modular structure with your icons, you're flying, right? What else do we have here?
Some of that you could accomplish by copying and pasting, right, from one file to another. But it,
you can.
Probably more laborious.
It is. Like
work smarter.
This is like your, but as you can see now, look at my layers. The layer thing, I still need to talk to David about it. I said, dude, you need to clean this up. You cannot, if you copy the same thing twice, it adds 5 layers. So compress it down before you do it. If you ever want to use your layers after doing this, make sure you do that first. But here you can see, this is probably just a hand. I took a picture and just traced it real quick. And as you can see, those types of drawings, it's a little low quality, as I notice on your screen, but become quite powerful. So that's the functionality on the right, where also, so if you double tap, let me show you where I am right now, real quick.
So are these all vector images then? There's underlying vector.
Yeah, these are all vector, but
to scale it.
Yeah, but it works with the pencil too. Oh, because they're allowing me to scale. Yeah, you're right. I think these are all just fill things. These are all little fill drawings. So if I select this guy, for instance, it's mostly just vector-based stuff. Yeah. And it's also one of the reasons, as you can see, I do use a little bit of pencil in here for that blue glow, but I tend to generally just stick to really iconic, simple vector stuff, which is a great way of working. The other one is, I got the blue arrow over there. If you double tap there, it comes up. So it's like a double tap on that thing. Then you can also obviously drop in photos straight from your camera, Adobe Cloud, right? So you can drop in, you make your Pinterest boards and then drop them straight in, right? Yeah, so that's it in a nutshell of this functionality. And then the upper right corner, now my rotates off, rotates still off. The upper right corner where you see the arrow now is obviously the export screen, PNGs, PDF, whatever you want, region or entire drawing, background or transparent, and then the resolution. And then you can go to export them. I think that kind of sums up the full circle of the concept functionality. And then all I can do is show you some of the ways I've worked with it in the past. This is not all new. A super quick way of doing concept work is obviously stealing, right? Just like good music. We're all DJs, right? We're no language piece that we do is original. Therefore, building on the language, the global design language is important. But here, for instance, we wanted to do an IKEA concept. So the quickest way to do that is to just literally draw right on top of it. All I did is stick a piece of paper out of that table and have that little wall concept on the wall. This is probably but the cool thing about it is, for a quick workshop or whatever, it works really well. I also made, one of the things I do is make, sketch video. So you switch on your record and then you draw, and then later you can use that video in iMovie to kind of direct a little movie of the creation of, and then you can tell the story of. I did that a couple of times with a concept. Let me see if I have it here.
How does concepts differ from Sketchbook Pro and some of the other programs? What is it about concepts that you find you like? Because I assume you've tried all these other things.
Yeah, I think, as you saw, the functionality, the combination, the cleanliness, it has a certain language of UI and also of the line weights and the vector aspects that I don't think Photoshop type things like pixel pushing, like Sketchbook Pro and stuff like that. For me, it's more like somebody who does portrait art or stuff like that, or landscapes, or, you know, you want to like get every pixel to be a certain tint. It's not as pure in its essence as concepts kind of diluted everything to the core essence of what you need as a product designer or as a clean product design artist, if you know what I mean. I find Procreate, to me, is just too much of a sketchbook. And Sketchbook Pro, I tried it for years, but I really hated it. I didn't like it at all. In here, I found this purest thing that is just wonderfully clean and simple and lightweight. that has everything that Illustrator has, but the horrible functionality of Illustrator, where everything's with the mouse, is I think it's less styling based. It's more for the pure concept. I don't know. I just it's hard to explain. Maybe in what I showed, this shows you a little bit the power of what I like about it. It's the speed and the simplicity and the clarity of the lines and the clarity of the colors. I don't know.
You've created the essence of objects really quickly without adding a ton of detail to them. And so in terms of a rapid thinking, rapid kind of ideation program, it lets you just lay down a lot of things without trying to nitpick it, I guess.
I think so.
You know,
I
and
think
really
so.
Detail it. It most of your illustrations here, the way that you've done them, are just super rapid. And when you zoom in on them or when you blow them up, they're not terribly detailed. And yet
right.
They really show, they are really giving us the idea of where you're going.
Right.
To get that idea quickly.
That's the power. Yeah, exactly. You go from a seed of an idea, boom, to concept. But the trick in here is that it's kind of painting with light. So therefore that Scott Robertson thing of knowing a little shadow, a little light, and then suddenly you zoom out and it pops, right? You can go detailed as well, right? It's not that you can only do this, but that's the way I use it in my daily work. Let's see if I can show you a variety of stuff. Identity work, for instance, design identity for ranges. So here, again, it's fairly rough, but this was a range of consumer kind of object, consumer printers for Sprocket that we did. So just capturing the essence of the range of the object, right? And that's where it's kind of essential. And then I quickly go into all kinds of note-taking. What other type of things can I show you that are completely different, for instance? Work notes, spout, architectures. Yeah, I have a page that's all about the demo, actually, the demonstration. That's this one. So here, I think this was a good one as far as printer concepts is concerned. Again, a few Pinterest mood boards and a range of how we can integrate 3D scanning into our current form language, for instance. So again, fairly simple palette. A little bit of color here and there, a little bit of pencil, but just capturing the idea. And then I would quickly print it on a photo or on a page and have a discussion around it. And the way to create these, where's my pencil? Would be, as you can see, the tools are all still there. So ideally you'd be able to quickly replicate it, set it on automatic. Don't forget that, that's always a big. And basically it's fairly, I don't use the, so there's no symmetry tool in here. So you got to kind of, now if you wanted the lines to be a bit cleaner, you'd obviously go with a smoothing in them or 100% straightness. And I think I just use a couple of grays here. Again, there's a good trick, by the way, I forgot to tell you. If you go to color picker, you float over a object. You see this thing here floating over an object. You can actually, by tapping, if I now go to the, I want to grab the orange. To select that orange and that tool, you tap that little box on there, and then you see it immediately switched. So now I have the exact same tool and the same orange again. This is critical for us because we always lose our settings. Do the gray. You can literally copy settings from a little darker gray. I don't know, these are fairly rough, right? But it shows you that with a little bit of, this is kind of how I would quickly build it up. And then there's probably there's a little bit of pencil in here actually to just give it a little bit of warmth. And again, because I have a gray background, I can sketch with light. Now these are not the world's most impactful drawings, but it's just a quick way to ideate. And then some other stuff is like this, where it's just probably layers of fills that I build up. This is kind of like the faster horse going to Mars. The interesting thing here is that it's actually, turn everything off, there's an actual DARPA bolt behind all of this. Where's my DARPA bolt? You see here, I love these things so much that I was like, what can we do with this crazy, you know, those dog robots that kick over the whole time at DARPA, at Boston Dynamics. So you take that and you start getting a little bit of a skeleton over it. And then I just did the blacks. This is just fills in blacks, literally just going, and then adding a few rocks, adding a few pieces of atmosphere on top. These are the early lines. Deleted those. Getting some more fills on there. Switched off the DARPA bolt. Get some more lines on there. And then the blue. Obviously here the touches, you see the glow there? So here it's nothing, right? But then the glow just, boom. It's the reflection on his face that I believed gives it that kind of sci-fi feel. And all it is just a little... It's just 100% blue fill right on there. So you could just go grab a little blue. I'm now obviously on the wrong layer. So if I go on top, I can just go. Right, and get a little bit of a suggestion of that going. Maybe something's hitting that still, right? And then the guy is sitting there in his blue. I don't want to ruin the drawing. So I undo, 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 undo. And there's the original. Product design visualization of some hobby project. This is actually a drone thing that I was, my wing drone, that's actually hanging up there. So I did 3D printed parts for this thing, which is one of the multi-jet fusion part. And there I think I'm just tracing this, this thing and just quickly get a few layers going here. It's messy because it's all on one layer, who cares? Straight line tool. And you just kind of start tracing it here and you say, this is kind of my wing. So again, cheating, stealing, just kidding. You know, you use your underlays well. And then you can quickly, now again, I'm drawing this probably on the photo. So that's messy, can't do anything with it. But just as a, and there I pulled up my color palette. I didn't do anything with it, but you can just pull stuff in and. So yeah, this one I did. What's the time actually, guys? How are we doing here? How long have we been?
It's 20 after 12.
Oh, if you so forget we've, time
we've
when you're
gone having- past your hour. Yeah, well, we're having fun. So what kind of pen are you using? Are you using Apple
it's
pen?
Just, it's just, this is just the first gen. It's about to die, I think. It's just the first gen Apple pen. This one was just an exercise in replicating that guy, so. Again, every layer is just is something. The wood, I guess I just did some tones to get to the wood. I'm not a real super powerful renderer guy at all, but if you did want to sit down and do something detailed, you can, right? You can go as far, I mean, there's some insane art that you can do with it. Yeah, no, just about to wrap things up, I guess. This is just a bunch of sketches in green. Take some rhino, quick rhino concepts. Throw some people on there. I think these are just some traced people. Rhino with some, this is our hologram table for the printers. And then some design identity sketches around those. Yeah, I just find it a crisp, simple, greatest tool for doing this stuff. Yeah, maybe that's about.
Well, it looks like it's great for rapid ideation.
It is. This was a really powerful one. We did, for instance, here, we just took a photo and just sucking up the color from the photo, doing a quick little printer concept in the environment. Like here, for instance, you see these are little statements of what a printer could be. And we actually took that quite far into concept land afterwards. But the ability, again, to draw directly on a mood board or do some cleaner art like this. Or do some other furniture type concepts like that. Yeah, I just find it extremely inspiring. I think that's about it. And I can go on, but it's probably maybe enough for you guys. I'm a big Alpha fan, so I always study. This is like a study of classic Alpha, right? This is a real car.
It's a a great way to learn how to do it is just by taking something that exists.
Yeah, I do it a lot to just get the skills going and practice with light. And I did a couple of those animated, so I actually draw it and then I record. And I post those. I have some of those. I speed them up and I put them on Facebook for people to look at. Diagrams and roadmaps also works really well, especially in combination with the modular tool thing on the right. Just drop stuff on your roadmap. You have these little icons and you can say, okay, guys, here's a roadmap. This project is killed in the meantime, unfortunately, but it was cool while it lasted. Any questions? Packaging work? Quick packaging sketches. You guys have questions that can answer? And the team of Concepts is phenomenally friendly and great people. You can always ask them questions as well. Or join the Facebook group. Here, this is some a little bit more cleaner artwork of modular systems. Modularity is, again, something that's really easy to do. Yeah, it's about it, I think, for me.
Well, awesome, Bart. Thank you for taking so much time to work with us on this and show us how you're working through these things.
Yeah, my pleasure.
It makes a wonderful portfolio, and the ability to just really zip through ideas quickly is pretty amazing, and that's what we're doing. We aren't creating fine art to put on the wall. We're creating visualizations of our ideas to get buy-in from other people to actually be able to make them. So,
yep, agree.
To get there quickly is really important. Having that kind of right kind of workflow process.
Agree. Yeah, and it's mean you just have the world in your pocket with Shaper 3D. I think Shaper 3D, if you can get the student version, I don't know if you guys use that at all. I think it's a super powerful combination. Those two combined, you just mock up a quick shape and then take a screenshot, drop it into any of your printer concepts would be perfect for Shaper 3D. It's really powerful. The combination of the two is like, all you need is a rendering app and you're completely done on your iPad. So yeah. Yeah. You can also go straight to CNC machines. I've seen people do that too from Concepts. If you have clean art, I don't know what format or whatever it would be, DWG or DXF, it can go straight to CNC machine. So if you're smart and you can draw your construction, you can push it out in a flat cut object or whatever.
Yeah,
as well.
The laser cutter too, then I would say.
Yeah, you should try that out. It's fun.
Great.
Yeah.
Anybody else have questions for Bart?
I think it was pretty cool. Yeah.
Sounds like it's clear.
This is the part about Zoom classes that I hate. You get to the end and you say, does anybody have any questions? And there's just all these blank faces and nobody says anything. I'm like,
it's
well,
hard.
I guess we're done.
Well, questions might come up. I think it's very abstract, you know, to talk through it. You probably have to try it. You need it runs on Windows too, by the way. So you need either a ZBook or something like that or an iPad Pro. I officially cannot endorse Apple products working for HP. We're not even allowed to use any Apple MacBooks or anything like that officially, which is, we have HPZ, so they have really good machines. So it's very abstract to see. You need to do it yourself, right? I think I see some people maybe sketching. I don't know if you have the ability to try it out there, but you need to try it out. So yeah, if you can always come back with questions later. So.
Well. Awesome. Thank you for so much time and just really, really appreciate it. I'll share the video with you and I'm going to share it with our faculty as well. They're interested in knowing more about it. So awesome. Thank you.
Okay, cool. Thanks, everybody. Have a great weekend.
Thank you.
Yeah,
we'll
thank
see
you.
You. Is it next week for the presentations?
not next week, but the following week.
The following week, yeah. I'm looking forward to it. Everybody's keen to see what you guys are up to.
Great, thank you.
And we talked to Joyce about a way to present to a broader forum in HP, and I think Joyce will probably...
I've already pitched it at them, and they think it's a good idea. So.
Yeah? Okay. Yeah. Excellent. All right.
Awesome.
Thanks everybody. Have a wonderful weekend.
You too.
You too.
Bye.